I mean, Dennis Allen, for a guy that I've heard categorized by some people as a retread, has seemed to have done an incredible job not following the same game plan as our previous coaching staff.
What's up, Houdat Nation, and welcome to the Dome Patrol United Saints Podcast.
What's up, Houdat Nation, and thanks for joining us on the Dome Patrol Podcast. I'm your host, Jeff, and in this episode, we're going to talk about practice. It's officially started, which means that we have some on-the-field things to respond to for the first time since the last time. And I assure you that Wesley, Jason, and Scott are going to be chomping at the bit to get to it. So put your seatbelts on, keep your hands and legs inside your earbuds at all times, and enjoy the show. Like I just said, we have Wesley, Jason, and Scott on this week's episode. We are talking about the things that have happened in Saints camp. So I'm going to ask the first question, and this is about, we're recording this on Monday. I think I saw the video today. Was it from today where Penning versus Turner, and we got a little punch thrown? My question is, did Penning cheap shot Turner first, which led to Turner taking a swing, or did Penning just play through the whistle and Turner got upset because he got by the rookie?
I believe that Penning already has a reputation for playing like there's through the whistle. he maybe has some like echo hearing where he's still hearing the whistle reverbing a few times. I think he said the right thing after practice. It's like, we're both competitors and there's no hard feelings and there's nothing left over. Like, we're just out there on the field. It's great to have these guys in pads though, because we can figure out, can Penning block people? And all we've heard for a week is that Peyton Turner looks like a first round draft pick and is knocking offensive linemen over and stuff like that. So it's nice that the offensive linemen can fight back now and we actually can have a battle.
Hard to see with those weird ass helmets they got. Those softies. What do you call them? I just call them a softie.
Right? I call them dark helmets. Look like, I call them Aaron Rodgers helmets.
They're like honeycombs.
Don't call them spaceball helmets.
Spaceballs.
Yeah. Supposedly, it's to reduce the amount of concussions. Sure.
Look, I'm all for it. I know it looks weird and we joke about it, but if anything, you know, especially since those guys hit on every single play, I'm all about it. So I don't care how ugly it looks. I know some players have been complaining about it, but.
But it goes on top of that. They shouldn't affect them. It goes on top of the helmet.
Yeah, but
like their helmet's on and it goes on top.
I mean, I was gonna say, like, how heavy are these things?
It's air. It can't be that heavy. It's probably foam.
Well, it's still Cam Jordan was saying like how some of his moves involve his, you know, moving his head in this direction. It's a little extra weight change. I mean, that micro aggressions, man, like they change everything. But I mean,
that'll just make his moves quicker. That'll just make his moves quicker.
That's what I'm thinking. I'm like, he's complaining about this, but at the end of the day, it's kind of like wearing a little extra weights on your ankles when you're walking or something or whatever. It's going to make you that much faster, quicker. It's like when you're batting, you put the weight on the bat whenever you're warming up and practice swinging so you can swing a little faster.
Y'all couldn't see this, but when Jeff said putting the weight on your ankles, he grabbed his wrist.
Well, I can't bring my foot all the way up on the camera.
No, I think you think your wrist is your ankle. That's what I think.
It also could be I'm a quadruped. Just mentally, it's hard to perform as an athlete when you look like a dork. So yeah. there's also that the
but everybody looks like a dork. Look,
even if there is no weight to it and doesn't affect you, just know you look stupid.
It was a little bit of an adjustment to go to these new helmets that they have now that are, you know, that look like motorcycle racing helmets, you know, and I remember back then, like when they first came out, we were all kind of like, I don't know. Now those are the good looking helmets and the old helmets look stupid, right? Well, maybe there's a day where an actual NFL game has these big honeycomb things on everybody's head.
Might be.
And it's everybody's playing the bubble wrap.
For like the old, like just the single bar, like the kickers used to wear.
Right, the kicker.
It's nice that the helmet's changing. We don't have to deal with hearing about Antonio Brown's theories on them and him missing 2 weeks of practice.
So that's how they ensure he's not coming back.
Yeah. For sure.
All right. So Penny versus Turner. Next one is the wide receivers are showing up early. And the fans on Saturday got their treat that we've all been waiting for. Jameis to Olave, 60-yard touchdown pass, right?
They did. I mean, it was a nice play for the offense. Defensively, they just let him run right down the field. It had to be a blown coverage or something.
What if they were like, let's give the fans a treat, y'all. Let's go.
Is that part of DA's new plan to
why not
make the fans happy?
Got to sell tickets. You got to sell tickets.
Jason, to be fair, it's probably CJ Williams and Smoke Monday back there, which will never be the combination in a game unless there's a whole bunch of suspensions and injuries and all. So, it is what it is. I mean, I'm glad that Jameis can throw a ball 60 yards. I'm glad Olave can catch the ball when it hits him in the hands. What happened with the coverage and all. And it was what was the best part of the whole thing is that Olave, he realized that 10 yards downfield, he threw his hand up like really early. He was seriously 12 yards downfield and he threw his hand up for a 60-yard pass. As soon as that safety stepped up, he realized that and Jameis saw it. So there will be teams this year with what we have with receivers and running backs. There will be teams this year that screw up, that bite on a play. And it's whether or not that receiver notices it and runs down the field and Jameis can throw the ball down there. We will see that in the regular season against a real defense in the NFL.
Yeah. And then
it's exciting to have a real running back room for a change. You know,
wide receiver room.
What did I say?
Running back.
Sorry.
I have
a drink. I've made a drink. So, I haven't had a drink on the show in a long time. So I figured
Is it a monster?
No, I didn't do a Dr. Monster. It's too early for that. I can't just rush into the Dr. Monster in a new season. I gotta wait.
I understand.
All right. Is Jarvis Landry impressing anybody also?
My goodness.
He had a play today where he put a move on a DB.
A play today that looked like I was guarding him. And I was like, I just looked at the player's number and I'm like, that number around sounds familiar, but everything gets moved around. I was like, I'm just going to go look on the roster and see like what undrafted free agent camp body this is. And it was Bradley Roby, which, and again, I just turned around and I wasn't too hard on Bradley Roby because I mean, Landry made an incredible move and he's done it his whole career to everybody. There wasn't a single cornerback in the NFL that would have been within 3 yards of him by the time he's catching the ball. But it's great to see that he's moving that way.
It's a nice rocker step,
man,
for all you aspiring wide receivers out there.
Jeff's learned some lingo since his boys are playing football now.
I like that. You're just going to keep tossing this stuff in there, and it's going to sound good. It's going to sound good until the one day he comes out and says something, and it's
well, it's better than calling it a Jimmy Jam.
It could be fun calling it a Jimmy Jam.
Jeff, I think we need to have a new segment where you come up with a new word every
today
show.
I learned.
Jimmy jamming in there.
All right. You're just jealous because you didn't know it was called a rocker step. All right. How is Jameis looking? So you talked about this big 60-yard pass, but a lot of people were talking before Saturday that he wasn't throwing anything deep, and you had a couple of interceptions that he was throwing. So what would you say to the people who are going to try to use that against him or against the Saints to suggest that we're not a playoff team and that Jameis isn't the guy that we think he's going to be?
Who are these people?
They're stupid.
National talking heads.
Well, look, they're not here seeing it. They don't, you know, and it's look, I kind of got the football bug. So I actually watched a little NFL live and, you know, you go through a bunch of segments and of course you're not going to see anything about the Saints, which is fine. It kind of seems like people forgot about us with Peyton moving on and with Breeze being gone. So I do like the fact we're going to.
They think Trevor Siemian's still our quarterback,
but the defense always starts off better in camp than the offense. So the offense has to play a little catch up. But it also speaks to the strength of the defense in the secondary, which we talked about, and that's even without Matthew even being here. I mean, this secondary is loaded, fucking loaded. Going to harass a lot of teams. They're going to be a problem for teams. So
having such a good secondary is only going to make our wide receivers that much better come, you know, regular season time.
I mean, again, this is the time, like he's saying. Also, we're just talking about specifically Jameis. I think it was unfair, and I've said this before on the show, it was unfair for Jameis last year to, you know, be named the starter right before week one when his whole preseason was a competition where he couldn't throw interceptions and couldn't play around and see what his receivers could do. And I'd love for somebody to break this down, but it seemed like so far that on the first couple series, Jameis has thrown interceptions. And then everybody's talked about that the rest of practice, he goes 4 for 4 or 5 for 6. It's like he maybe at the start kind of does goof around to see, like, you know, can I throw this here? And then he's like, okay, I got to show y'all that I can, you know, complete passes. But what we're seeing with, if Adebo is making the second year step that everybody says, again, he's been the MVP of camp so far. If he's making this second year leap that it looks like so far, you've got a incredible secondary going on. Cause I mean, Marshawn is going to follow around the best wide receiver. Adebo's always going to be against a number two or number three, depending on who's lined up in the slot. And then you got, you know, we know what Chauncey can do, and then what these two, you know, safeties can do on against nickels and tight ends. This is, I mean, could be incredible. And we've talked about for years how the cornerbacks and the defensive ends play off of each other. You make that quarterback hold the ball an extra 0.4 seconds, they're getting hit by our defensive ends that also seem like they could be pretty incredible this year. This really could be a vaunted defense. We might right now, our offense is going to practice all preseason against what might be the best defense they play all year.
And I know one good thing is seeing May back there, cause he was coming off an Achilles injury last year, and reports are that he looks good. And that, in addition, you know, forgetting possible suspension or whatever, just coming off a big injury like that, there was a question of, you know, what would he look like when he comes back? Would he be ready?
Well,
he looks ready.
I believe Underhill was the one that said that, you know, Underhill's always been a big fan of Marcus Williams having the greatest range of any safety in the NFL. He immediately said that, like, let me just say, Marcus Williams is great at this, but I'm seeing May play, and May's got some crazy range too. He's saying it doesn't look like it's as big of a step back in that range than what is what we maybe originally thought.
I mean, the story last season was our defense was really, really good, and our offense wasn't able to play up to their level, right? Like, Breeze was gone. If Breeze had this defense, we would have done this, and this. Well, not only did we maintain that defense, we made it better. And now the offense, with all these wide receivers bringing in, made them better.
And a healthy Jameis.
I mean,
I was gonna say, and with Trevor Siemian,
right? Well, but
I mean, look at where we were with Jameis and the shitty receivers for last year.
If Siemian would have had these receivers, Taysom, you know, who knows what we would have had?
Well, Taysom did have these receivers, and he didn't do anything with them either.
And the other thing with Jameis too, if he's under, if we've got people running downfield at 50 yards and he's under throwing them at the 42 yards, throwing these interceptions like that aren't competitive, I want Jameis working on his short game. That's always been the knock, is does he have the short game? If he's going to throw 12, you know, practice or passes in practice in the short game and throw a couple interceptions, that's good. Let's work on those. We need him
offensive scheme.
That's the time to do it.
On a guy that's ran past the safety and is 60 yards downfield. I don't think he's ever going to lose that ability.
Right. So that's not what he needs to practice.
and I honestly think we're going to see a whole bunch of that this year in regular season. Like, we're going to see him throw the ball downfield. But that has to be set up with the short game. So if he's throwing interceptions at the sideline and stuff like that, I'm fine with that as long as it's cornerback. What we can't have is him throwing interceptions to the invisible linebacker in the middle of the field that he just doesn't see. That was always his problem, is just, oh, where'd that linebacker come from?
He got that LASIK now.
Yep. So
see him. He's got the boy's eyes, the Homelander eyes now.
There you go.
Taking the V. All right, you mentioned the secondary and saying how strong they're going to be. Y'all talked about them, but one guy you did not mention is the Honey Badger, Tyrann Mathieu, who has been MIA. Maybe. Well, because I don't know where the fuck he is. What's the deal?
It is kind of weird. I mean,
attending to family matters.
He's regretting his decision, is he?
I mean, there's no chance.
Yeah, I mean, if you were going to have a player miss time during training camp, it's best to have a veteran who's been in the league 15 years and could pick stuff up really easily.
I mean, isn't it an issue of, I know he's more mature about a lot of things, but him being back in New Orleans, now he's closer to a lot of family members and shit like that. Are they, you know, maybe possible family members trying to take advantage. Obviously, we have no idea what the situation is.
Right.
From what I understand, I don't even think he's in the state of Louisiana right now. I could be wrong about that, but I think he left town.
It's too damn hot.
So I don't think the NOLA thing is a thing.
I think if it had anything to do with the New Orleans Saints, then they would not be saying the things they're saying. It would be, well, yeah, he's missing, what's $75,000 a day for every day he's not here. You can ask Tyron why he wants
to throw that money. It's got to be something serious.
I think it's something serious, but I also think it's something completely personal that has nothing to do with the New Orleans Saints, has nothing to do with anything about the NFL. And he's just, you know.
I hope, like, yeah, my concern at this point is, like, whatever it is, that it's something that he can, whether it's him, his family, somebody, I don't know, but, like, that they can overcome whatever it is. I mean, something like, could it be, I mean, what if somebody's close to him's fighting cancer, or what if he's fighting cancer and we don't know, or what if it's something else that's unrelated to health but could be some kind of PR deal he's got to deal with. I don't know,
his favorite uncle could, you know, have something going on and he just wants to be there for him. I mean, we never know. There could be a divorce between his two favorite aunt and uncle, and I mean I'm gonna guess that it's something extremely personal, and honestly, like, there's something that we've lost the ability to have, which is that disconnection of that these guys do have personal lives with everything with social media and all. It's impossible to kind of have that. So I understand the speculation, but this is something that 15 years ago none of us would have even known what was going on or cared questioned. Like, oh, we'll see him for week one.
Well, I think part of it too is, it's of all people, it's Tyron Matthew, who we've been so excited about having joining this team, and now we still have to wait a little bit longer.
Hey, would you rather have
kind of like waiting for Michael Thomas to come back?
I was going to say, which would you rather have? Would you rather have Tyron here and where is Michael Thomas, or Michael Thomas is practicing and Tyron's dealing with a personal issue? He'll be here soon.
Right.
I'll take this.
I'll take the latter. Yeah. All right. One of the position battles that we were all curious watching a couple of episodes ago that we mentioned was the Adebo versus Roby versus Taylor. And if what you all said was Adebo having the best camp out of everybody, then Adebo's winning that battle.
After 4 days, yes.
Let's see it in preseason.
I think the good news is here is that, and apparently Roby, I mean, even though he had that huge loss to Jarvis, he has looked good in camp and has, you know, won his more of his wide receiver battles than he's lost. And we're hearing great things about Alante Taylor. A video came out today of Taylor sticking with Olave, and Olave actually made a really good adjustment to try to get the ball. And I mean, Taylor was with him the whole way and real confident. Taylor looks like he's probably ahead of where Adebo was this time last year, which is great. Having said that, Adebo looks like he is way ahead of where he was last year too. I mean, it looks like we're going to have a really talented, possibly starting caliber cornerback coming off the bench. Whether that's for goofy alignments or certain receivers rotation we want them set up against, or whether that's somebody gets injured, like it seems like, and I would much rather have it this way than this guy is clearly good and this guy clearly doesn't belong in the starting lineup.
Right.
I'd much rather have a debate.
Imagine having Jason David.
Ken Crowley? Say it with me. Adebo.
Dude, I mean, but think about Adebo. Like, what if Adebo turns out to be one of the, a Jabari Greer, like an all-time greats?
Pretty fantastical.
Man, there's stuff that you see.
Hurt. That's there's the best stuff part. Like, what if he doesn't get hurt?
There's stuff that you see from his college tape that was like, if this guy, because he was a wide receiver who became a cornerback and just was natural going after the ball. He's playing defense, and it looked like he was the person that the quarterback was throwing to over and over again. Now, again, those are highlight tapes.
Right, you're looking at the highlight. Yeah, the highlights but there was
30 of them. It was the highlight tapes, but it wasn't seven plays. It was a bunch of plays.
Yeah, and his breaks on the ball. You're right. Man. Like, I mean.
And he didn't even play the prior season because of COVID. So he came in last year, played pretty solid for a rookie who didn't play an entire season in college. So
the whole thing on Adebo is, if he could get a little bit physical where he could not just get knocked off the line, he terrible press coverage. He couldn't get up and, you know, get and slow down a receiver at all. And he's apparently done good with that in 4 days. Again, I agree, Jason, but if, nope, if this nope, is a guy that you're like, if he takes the things he's good at and like works on these other things, he looks like a possible elite level cornerback. And it's so far, it looks like he's following the game plan. And maybe the drafting Taylor, even if Taylor never plays, if drafting Taylor made Adebo become the second best cornerback in football, like awesome. Like whatever it took. So I mean,
you can't have too many talented players.
I'm good with it.
Right. But believe it, we've seen a lot of shitty secondaries on this team. So the units that they've been able to put forth over the last couple of years have been look, it's going to be exciting to watch. You know, it's so amazing how quickly camp is here, and then just instantly I'm all in 100%. I want to watch. Like, I'm fully invested. I want the season to start tomorrow. Like, I am ready. Just like that.
First and preseason game a week from Saturday.
Right. And I'm going to be so excited for the preseason game. And after five plays, I'm like, all right, I'm done. But some of it too, I think is, even though last year was a new era without Breeze, like this is really a new era without Sean. And I always thought that, man, once we lose Sean and Breeze, we're going to be shit for 3 or 4 years until we can hope to rebuild. And yet, I mean, here we are. Like, this team is strong. It's amazing how Loomis has been able to survive the Breeze and Peyton exodus and still field a team, which I know it's early, 4 days, but that we think, is a clear playoff team. And I just did not see this. If you'd have told me this 10 years ago, I'd have been like, impossible. You're lying. I'll bet a stake on it. I mean, I've lost, and I'd be ready to pay up.
This is honestly a team, if stays healthy, should be better than it was the last couple of years with Peyton and then even Breeze's last year. This is, I mean, there's a real possibility for a lot of wins.
Speaking of the transition, Dennis Allen, everybody, like, you know, the joke, everybody was kind of like, what a choice they made. And then he made the choice to keep Park Carmichael as their OC, and people were concerned. And I don't mean this as a joke, but there were some people with legitimate concerns about
whether or not this was going to be,
some of the trying to retread. And okay, so the two of you, Scott, Jason specifically, do you feel the same right now? Or how would you characterize your position on the Dennis Allen-led New Orleans Saints now?
Look, he can give a bunch of speeches in preseason. It sounds great. Training camp, it sounds great. Look, Peyton never said a word, so anything coming on from Peyton is going to sound different. And yes, DA does say some things. They're like, it's just different. I mean, we've had 15, 16 years of a certain way that the team has been presented by the head coach, and now it's completely different. So it's
do
a
you
shock.
Like the new way?
It's a shock. I mean, it's fine. I mean,
I'm not saying, do you like it better, but you can like two things once.
You know, I'm always excited to hear what the coach has to say, whether even when Peyton talked, even though he didn't say anything, I was all excited to hear him talk. But but it's not going to change. I mean, look, they haven't played a game yet. So I hope to God it works out. This team is talented enough to work out.
The one game that Dennis Allen did head coach for the New Orleans Saints, we won.
We shut out Tom Brady. Yeah. Look, I'm very excited.
So he does have a skin on the wall.
So look, I hope to God it works out, but that is something we haven't really talked about, even though there's a ton of talent, it appears on paper, a ton of talent on this team. I mean, the change from Sean, I know we were getting kind of tired of Sean, but man, the attention to detail from Sean, the things he does behind the scenes that you don't see, that's the kind of thing that separates the, solid, mediocre head coaches from the great head coaches. We'll see if Dennis has that. You know, we won't know until we start to get the results and see the game. So,
all right, Scott,
I didn't have so much of an issue with DA. I was fine with that. It was more the Carmichael thing, I think, was my thing. And we haven't played a game yet, so I can't really say one way or the other. I'm kind of in the same boat as I was before. Like,
well, thanks for chiming in, Scott.
I mean, we haven't done anything.
You're right. Right. There's been
things
no.
Things are
we've
different.
Had four I mean, days, we've had 4 days of right. practice. Four
things
days.
Are different. Everything you said about Sean Payton, everything that you said about Sean Payton was actual descriptions of more of a culture. And you didn't say anything in your entire statement, Jason or Scott. Well, Scott, you a little bit, but Jason, about his coaching on the field on game days. You talked about everything you talked about was about Sean Payton and the culture that he created. So look at what Dennis Allen has done. He has created a different culture.
Is it that different though? We don't know. You don't know what the culture is. You don't know. We've had 4 days. Also, it's not the culture. Jeff, it's not the culture. The culture is already here. The culture is set. The question is, how does he?
So it's Sean Payton's culture
that we I don't think
it's 100% Sean Payton's culture. Like, he said,
it DeMario Davis's culture or Cam Jordan's culture just as much as it was Payton's?
Like, it's the team that was set in place, you know, at the end of last year. This is the culture that's here. But what is DA going to do to ensure that things still get done the right way? That falls on DA to keep this culture going. You know, that's what we'll find out when the games start occurring, and we'll see what happens. I mean, nobody knows what goes on behind closed doors. He comes out and gives a good speech that everybody likes. I mean, yeah, it's great. I enjoy it. But we don't know what effect and what the results are going to be. How's it going to look on game day? I don't think he can do it.
Media access. He's given a little bit more.
He's actually answering questions.
Okay, yeah. Sure.
Okay. And what he's doing around the city, like recognizing he had an interview in kind of questions that he answered about the importance of the head coach of the New Orleans Saints in the city of New Orleans and how he views and takes that and how the relationship between the coach and the city is important.
He's maybe telling more you so what you want to hear.
Got to sell tickets, Jeff. You got to sell tickets.
Look, I'm not saying he's wrong.
Fucking sold out.
Fire me up. I'm not saying he's wrong. Look, I'm all in.
So you're saying, so you don't believe he believes that? You think he's genuine? He's being completely disingenuous and he doesn't believe that?
Yeah,
he's
not what I'm saying.
You think he's a snake oil salesman?
That's not what I'm saying at all.
He's a slithery, slimy snake.
Don't put words in my mouth.
No, well, hey, one thing with this conversation, have to give credit to Mickey Loomis for the team that he put around not only Dennis Allen, but also Jameis Winston. If Jameis Winston comes in with health, if this team is healthy, and doesn't do well throwing the ball, it is not Mickey Loomis or the coach's fault. I mean, this team is set up for Jameis to be able to throw the ball downfield. And it's also set up for Dennis Allen to be able to have the offense be successful while he focuses still on the defense. And we've kept this defense. If we are healthy and we don't play well, it ain't anybody's fault besides probably Jameis and Dennis Allen. Like, it's going to be real clear. They've been set up for success. Now they've got to do their job. Now there's coaches that could come in here and screw this up.
Should hold other teams to less than 20 points on average, maybe even less than 18.
And this offense should be able to score three touchdowns a game.
Yeah, I mean, last year's offense could score two sometimes, one and a half
sometimes.
That's really simple.
We could kick three field goals.
They wouldn't make three field goals, but they could kick them.
And Lutz hasn't missed in preseason.
Right. But I mean, yeah, you think about it. Like, this offense, if this offense cannot score 21 points per game, that's a Jameis Winston problem. Or Pete Carmichael problem.
Yeah. So we don't know. We don't know yet.
Right. We'll find out.
I can't wait for everybody to over. You mentioned the preseason game coming up a week from Saturday. I can't wait for everybody to overreact to everything that they see in that game.
We're overreacting to daily training camp practices. Wait,
are you saying that if Marquez Callaway catches two impressive balls in the first quarter, that we might possibly anoint him wide receiver one and say that all of our problems moving forward are over? Would we do that?
And then ridicule anyone who suggests that we don't have a wide receiver problem for the next 3 weeks or 4 weeks in the season? Yeah. All right.
Still the greatest part is he caught those two balls. They pulled it, or three balls. They pull him out of the game. We're like, his preseason's done.
He's done.
Let's not get him hurt.
Might have could have used a little.
Peyton's like, I like the guys in our room.
Maybe could have used a little more
practice. That's why it was time for Peyton to go. Boy, if Nick Energy was still listening, vindication is his. Right.
He picked the wrong time to quit.
Right. He might still be listening for.
He might still. He just hadn't tweeted at us.
Yeah, he hates us.
Very angry.
Yeah. He hates us.
He hates us because we supported Sean Payton for three more years than him. All right, so another reason why we might lose a game is Kamara could potentially be suspended. But today, his lawyers went into court and asked for another delay in hearing, and then it was granted for what, another 2 months?
60 days, which coincides with 2 months.
So, so from both sides, plaintiffs and defendants, there are four lawyers here. All four lawyers came in and said, "We're not ready for this. Can we please have some more time?" Listen, we have no idea what's going on. That them all being on the same page versus one of them being like, "No, we've got the video. I'm ready to go. I don't need a continuance." All four of them being on the same page makes me feel like there might be some negotiation going on to where some people are in the future unwilling to work with the police and unwilling to testify. And maybe somebody comes out and go, "You know what? This could have been my fault.
Ornstein in
this could have been my fault that him and all his friends beat the crap out of me. I feel like I crossed the line." There may be someone else that got assaulted, like owning this and saying that it's their fault and that everything's fine here in the near future while Alvin writes a check that we never hear about.
Yeah. But do you think, like, we called, what's his name? Is it Ornstein? The guy, you know, the fixer, Sean Payton's little fixer to go to rough some people up, a little Tony Soprano style.
Is Harvey Keitel in Las Vegas right now?
You are not going to press charges against Alvin Kamara.
Called the wolf.
Is there a scenario here where he misses no games?
Yeah. I mean, there's always a chance that he can miss no games.
I think at least this season. I think this season, yes, there's a very good chance he misses no games. To think that he misses no games ever is hard. I think everybody would have to come out with a pretty joint kind of weird press conference with the guy that got assaulted going, "Listen, I deserved exactly what happened to me. You guys don't know what I said, but it was pretty terrible," which I don't see. I think that even when this gets dropped, and I think he probably gets two games for just the Chiefs
the
guy might be
the one brought on to the Pro Bowl.
The Chiefs cornerback looks like he might really be the guy in trouble regardless, because, I mean, he went to town.
He threw the first punch too, right? I mean, Kamara actually hit the guy
six times while he was laying on the ground. Yeah. Like,
but I mean, Kamara stomped him. Like,
did he?
Didn't he?
But maybe he was trying to kick the cornerback from punching him. He was trying to block the punches with his foot.
I think there was a piece of trash on the ground. He was trying to kick away.
Did we really have the best angle of the
it's
video?
Kind of blurry, pixelated. What if it was not Kamara at all, but rather someone wearing a Kamara, like,
people do dress up as celebrities in Vegas, Jeff.
Yeah, like, kind of cosplay.
I met the guy from The Hangover. He had the baby with him. The baby hasn't grown at all in the last, 12 years?
I'm just saying it might not have been him at all.
It's very possible,
because I think, like, he was actually on site in New Orleans filming a Labord and Earls commercial on that night before.
Is that a law firm?
Yeah,
it is.
That's the one he represents.
Yeah,
actually, I haven't seen a
commercial in a while.
Labord and Earls commercial. Right, they moved on to another player.
I think the last one I saw was Taysom Hill.
Is it? No, I didn't see a Taysom. Who did I see? I feel like it's a Zach Streif type or whatever.
Because their phone number is all sevens.
Is that prenups? Taysom needs seven or eight of those. He needs proper representation.
Is he Mormon?
I mean, it seems like it would only make sense that there's some sort of negotiation going on to make this all go away. And
it'd be great.
I don't know if the cornerback from the Chiefs has the money to pay for it.
So the NFL also, they kind of can't pass judgment or suspension yet until this kind of comes out in the wash.
The video comes out publicly.
Okay. Well, also, maybe before that, they are waiting to see any kind of precedent. Like, what are they going to do with the Deshaun Watson case and wait to see what happens with that?
I mean, they suspended him six games. Yeah.
So the NFLPA tweet. So the NFL said six games, or the NFLPA?
The judge suspended him six games.
Yes.
The person who gets
to decide the suspension. There's a former judge.
Not like the judge in the court of law, but the judge as decided by the NFLPA and the NFL.
Basically, when the NFL could do the suspensions, the last thing they did was the Calvin Ridley suspension, where they suspended him for a year. And then after that, this new system came together where there is a former judge who gets to decide. Now, if the NFLPA thinks the suspension is too long, they can appeal saying, "No, we want it to be less games." Now, having said that, the judge doesn't work for the NFL or the NFLPA. So actually the NFL can also appeal saying, we think the suspension should be longer.
Didn't the NFLPA come out and said they weren't going to appeal it?
Right. Because they're happy with it being six games.
Right. The NFL now, could appeal it.
The rumor is that the NFL is going to appeal saying they want the suspension to be longer because the NFL recommended to the judge to suspend him for a year. Here's where it gets kind of funny. So If the NFL appeals the suspension, the person who decides the appeal is Roger Goodell.
It's so stupid.
That's what the players agreed to in the CBA. So
I see it probably getting in the 10 to 12 game range. I'm not sure if he's going to really completely nut up and make it a full year. I think he wants to. If she'd have made it eight games, I think he'd have made it a year. But her making it six, and I don't really have a pulse, a finger on the pulse of, is everybody pretty irritated about this? Are y'all seeing on Twitter? I can't imagine anybody besides Cleveland Brown fans thinking this is makes sense.
I think they probably like the six games.
I'm sure they're.
I can think of a few Saints fans and podcasters who
I know
probably think he should be like kicked out of the NFL forever
and canceled. That one player in particular is upset as Calvin Ridley because he bet the under. He thought it was going to be a year and he took the under. So.
It is going to be interesting because what's going to happen is Goodell's going to see all the outrage and the NFL reacts. The NFL is not proactive. The NFL reacts. The public overall public perception is it's not long enough and he's going to add to it. React. But yep. I mean, could you factor in, he didn't play at all last year. Now I know it wasn't an official suspension, but
you think like he gets a little time served?
Well, he missed an entire season last year. Does that? I know it's not technically part of the case.
He didn't miss any money though.
Oh well, okay.
That was just the team.
He's not going to miss it. He's not going to miss much money this year either.
He was just excused from practice and made inactive on game days. He was paid 100% of his salary last year.
In essence, he got suspended with pay.
So here's a thought: like the fact that the Browns structured their contract so that if he gets suspended this year, he misses no money. It defeats the purpose of the suspension.
Yep.
What I think they ought to do is suspend him in 2023. Let him play this year.
Play this year.
And actually hit him because the suspension isn't about hurting the Cleveland Browns. The suspension is supposed to be about hurting his pocket, his earning potential.
Which so yesterday he got a $15 million check. Yesterday right. He was given $15 million.
Which he used because he reached like, three
they circumvented the system. And if the NFL suspends him this year, they just basically are almost saying we really don't care about anything other than like Jason, you're saying the optics of
right.
The fans. I agree it's in theory. Like, I don't think there's anything in the structure of the deal that allows them to make it to where he gets suspended next year, though. It requires due process, it's going to have to be in a timely manner.
Goodell's going to pull a LaToya and wait to see how the public reacts and then decide whether or not to.
And still get it wrong?
Right. Yes. I mean, this was.
And get
this
a fight was, in the bathroom?
This was the first time out of like 10 times where she actually caved to public pressure.
Yeah, no, I was kind of
What'd she do? What's this one? What's this new one?
She was going to travel again. She was going to go to Singapore.
Singapore.
It's going to be her third foreign trip in a month.
And she was going to be the only mayor in the United States to go, right?
Yes, the only one.
To go. And it was about, it wasn't about like environmentalism or something.
How to deal with climate disasters climate. And shit like that, climate which is important change, yeah. for New Orleans. But if you didn't already go to Sweden Denmark, and wherever else you went, France, we have too many sister cities. But I definitely agree with you, Jeff, in that. But that goes back to like Cleveland structured the deal because they knew it was coming, and yet he's going to be able to circumvent this and still get all this fucking money. And there's nothing anybody can do about it, really.
I also love that our bias is clear and obvious because I guarantee you, if we would have signed him, we'd be arguing the complete, like, they shouldn't suspend him at all. This is bullshit.
Yeah. I believe that I'm being honest on this. I supported trading for him and like what was rumored that we had to trade. I would have felt dirty and bad if we gave him the contract the next day. Regardless of where I wanted, I think he's a talented quarterback and wanted him on the team and would have given up quite a bit for him. The contract's dirty. That's not right. And if I could choose to not have him, and the only way to get him was to do that contract, I'm glad we didn't get him.
Yeah.
You know what would have happened if we would have signed him? Like, Adell would have suspended him, and then the game he came back, they would have suspended Kamara for the rest of the season.
So, you know, the one thing,
Kamara in London.
I mean, yeah, now, but like the one thing is, oh, if Deshaun only gets 6 games, then Kamara's getting what, 1? But yeah, Goodell can go back and. But the thing is, like, if Kamara settles, nothing goes to trial, no judge is ruling against him, it's strictly going to come down to what does the NFL give him.
If they get a settlement that it doesn't go to court and nobody press charges and the Las Vegas Police Department doesn't pick it up and the video doesn't come out.
Well, that's key.
It's really difficult to spend tomorrow. It is.
Didn't part of the video come out already?
No, the
images?
There was some images. There was the description of the video that the police watched. The full-on description of the video is out there. But as long as there's no video, he's kind of safe. I think that if the video comes out, he probably gets 3 games. Just the video with no criminal charges, mm-hmm. and nobody. I think it's going to be
3.
But
it's going to be 3.
But I guess this 60-day delay, I mean, that's October 1st. That's the game's October 2nd. So he's pretty much guaranteed for London.
Well, and he's
can he leave the country
in 60 days on October 1st? He's going to be out of the country. They're not going to make him come. They're not going to even have the.
Will they allow him to leave the country?
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Can he leave the country?
Yep, for sure.
On a work visa.
So you tell me, we are going to have a fun Sunday and Sunday night. No Nashville rock bottoms for us.
All right. With that, was there any other things I missed from training camp?
I think is great. Saints, the most targeted receiver in so far in team drills has been Adam Troutman with 8 targets.
How many
and
catch?
The leader in catches during team drills is Adam Troutman with 7. So pretty awesome. I mean, again, Adam Troutman's been the one that has made some incredible catches and plays in his career that you're like, wow, do that all the time. And he's a fantastic tight end, but he's also had some boneheaded drops and lots of things like that. So if he's getting to the point where he's working that out now in his third year, that's the tight end is a big question mark for us.
Well, and even Kroll's had a decent 4 days so far. Too. So yep. It's like they're going to have options. I mean, Juwan Johnson may not make it. I mean, I know I had Nick, especially Taysom Hill's 100% healthy, which is kind of nuts.
That's but, something I wanted
you
to
know, if you factor in Taysom, Troutman for sure, and then who's your third? Again, that's where it comes down. Like Kroll, can they like, oh, he's got an injury, he's out on IR, he's on the practice squad to kind of save him? Because I feel like that's the kind of guy they may not be able to just cut him.
Yeah, I agree. I don't think he's making it to the practice squad. They've got to
right. Mm-hmm. So that's when it comes down to: can one of them block well enough to be able to cut Nick Vanette? But it seems like Juwan Johnson. Bye bye, donkey.
Yeah, I mean he's average. It's okay. You'd be fine with that. But so one thing I wanted to bring up. So on Locked On Saints, Ross Jackson was talking about the benefit of having Taysom Hill in the tight end room and saying, you know, where else are you going to get? Like, he played quarterback, and now you have a quarterback in the tight end room that's going to help people like Troutman understand this is what the quarterback's looking for, yada 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 yada. And I'm sitting here thinking as I'm listening, I'm like, Ross, hold on a minute. Like, do you really want Taysom Hill telling
if Taysom Hill would have been able to know what the quarterback's supposed to be looking at, then he would have been looking at it when he was playing quarterback.
Thank you. That's what I'm sitting here thinking. I'm like, no, Taysom, shut the fuck up. Like, don't no, you stop. Let Jameis visit the room and tell him what he's looking for. Yeah, Taysom Hill. Oh, Troutman, actually, on this, right here, I want you to do that so that I can tuck the ball and run.
Our other question.
I'm not going to throw it to you.
Our other questionable position has been running back, and apparently Malcolm Brown looks like he's still got something today. Like, he looked good, and I really think that when they start tackling, I think Abram Smith's going to make a huge name for himself this preseason. He's already looked good and found places and made some good – he had made a couple cuts when they were just in shorts, not tackling the other day. That dude's going to be looking for contact big time whenever they get pads and start tackling.
like the dog in this team. All right. Any final thoughts?
I've got one, but I wonder if I should save it for last.
All right. Scott, you got anything?
No.
He takes a deep breath. And now. I think it's LSU, a final thoughts. No Brian Kelly speaking at the Rotary Club. Nothing.
I mean, they had SEC Media Day a couple weeks ago. Everything looks good. They're still getting, you know, commitments for the next few years. You know, four-star commitments. They got an offensive lineman, four-star commitment coming in. It's supposed to be really good. I'm just ready for some football, man. Let's go.
I think we got August 6th. We've got one of the best receivers in the country is committing. Rumor is he's going to be LSU. So
they put up a new statue of Pete Maravich.
No, my kids don't. Cool. They're not going to commit until like 3 years, 4 years from now.
They're going to go to Stanford.
Well, I told them that. Don't one of them go to Hawaii. I'll come visit you and go to those games. All right, Wesley, final thought.
Yeah, just on quarterback room. I think that Andy Dalton, the day it was made, I said that's an underrated, incredible signing. It's a guy that went to the playoffs a whole bunch. Still, the last 2 years with Chicago and Dallas, when he played, he could still play quarterback in the NFL. Like, he wasn't going to take either one of those, you know, decimated teams and lead them to a Super Bowl, but he played NFL quarterback. Apparently, he's still out there and he's slinging the ball. He's doing a really good job, like, challenging cornerbacks and getting receivers open. If he has to play a couple snaps or a couple games, I think we'll be just fine with this crew. And then the other, right behind him, I think we've got to really find out this preseason what we have with Ian Book. We cannot, if he's not good, I'd like to find that out right now and not even use a roster spot on him if he's not going to, if he doesn't look like he's going to develop. Now, again, I'm just saying, if he's not going to develop in a couple years to where he could be the backup quarterback, let's find that out and figure out if we need to move on and start doing something else. Or you know, can he actually, you know, I think it's unfair to, you know, judge him on the one game he played. It was, he had no team around him. We had, you know, 40 people or whatever suspended from COVID. That's not really a fair assessment of what he can do, but we got to find out this preseason if Ian Book can play backup quarterback in the NFL.
He threw a duck today.
I'll tell you, he underthrew it by like 10 yards.
Well, there you go. I'll tell you something else about Andy Dalton and his impact on this team. Again, Ross was talking about this on the same episode. About like when asked, like, what is your role on this team? And Andy Dalton said, my role is to make sure that Jameis is the best. Like, he's not here to compete and take Jameis's job. He's here to make Jameis better. And when he was talking about it, I'm sitting here thinking, like, Jameis last year would come to the sideline, and you know what quarterbacks he has to talk to and say, like, hey, what are you seeing from the sideline? Trevor freaking Simeon, Ian Book, and maybe Taysom Hill, who actually couldn't really talk about it because he was on the field too. So now you're coming to the sideline and you have Andy Dalton watching and sitting here and consulting and looking at the plays with you. That alone is an upgrade for just like what you're going to do while the defense is on the field.
It's also a compliment to Jameis, because two seasons ago, Andy Dalton was doing that for Dallas and he said the same thing. Like, I'm here to help Dak be a... Last year he went to Chicago and he didn't say, I'm here to teach Justin Fields. He's like, I'm here to be the quarterback. and then now he's back. So it's not like he's just at a place in his career where he doesn't care. Because last year, he knew he was the best quarterback on that team. Yeah. And he was willing to tell everybody. So it just shows that it's also respect for Jameis. Right. That he knows what Jameis can do and what he signed for.
And right. And he's played in, what, 7 different offenses in his career. So the guy has seen it all.
That's going to be another, like, really good offensive coordinator, quarterback coach, a guy in Jameis's ear constantly. And also, that's when Jameis needs a break. That's a guy that can actually go in there and play quarterback and get these receivers some work.
Yeah.
And do that job.
And without losing a step, kind of, you know,
for sure.
A little bit of a step. Jason, what's your final thought?
So in my Saints fever that I developed on Saturday, I got a little excited and I said, I need something Saints. So I decided to watch the 2009 Saints game against the Redskins. I have a Blu-ray set that's got that game and then the 3 playoff games. And it's interesting because there's a lot of games in 2009 a lot of people remember. And in the Washington game, everybody remembers the meet around, but they don't necessarily remember anything else about the game at all.
I remember that being a very ugly game and a hard-fought win. Like, we barely won that game.
I have 3.5 pages of notes that I
took.
Oh,
shit. So,
now, look, I'm not going to go through all these notes, but it did give me...
Chapter one.
It did give me practice, so I may try to do this for this season to actually take notes in games and not try to remember things when I'm drunk, because it's not going to work out. Mm-hmm. But it was interesting. You know, this game, it was the week after the New England game, so we were 11-0. We were on the road. We were without Jabari Greer, Tracy Porter, Randall Gay. Our top three cornerbacks did not have. We also didn't have Scott Fujita. So, and I guess maybe I didn't catch it, or with the replays, they didn't specifically state it until later in the game. But I'm like, dude, Jason Campbell was moving the ball at will. And I'm like, what happened? And like, there was one play where like, wait, we have a cornerback named McAllister. I'm like, who the fuck is McAllister? Like, I totally forgot. It wasn't Kevin McAllister. But I totally forgot that there was a McAllister. It wasn't Deuce. And then eventually McAllister ended
Mike,
up causing
Mike McAllister.
Mike McKenzie did play a role. I was like, wait, oh yeah, team. I was like, man, McKenzie's in here too. But it was Chris McAllister, former Baltimore Raven. And like when that came out, I was like, okay, I remember him now.
Wow.
He did force the fumble in overtime, which I'll get to. But yeah, it was a rough game. A lot of penalties. The Saints ran a lot of screens. We couldn't run the ball.
3 days later,
Washington ended up taking a big lead. I mean, they scored the next 10 points. They went up 27-7. All we could do was kick a few field goals.
My favorite thing is that from like February to now, we had nothing to talk about. Barely anything going on.
Those Why didn't you watch those
times,
videos?
Perfect times for you to watch the entire 2009 season and walk us through that. But you wait until a week into training camp when we have literal 2022 Saints football to talk about, and you want to give us a 17-minute detailed recap, play-by-play, of the Saints versus the Washington Redskins in 2009.
I mean, I go dark in the offseason. I don't like I turn my Saints brain off.
I can't imagine what you would have detailed it as if you had watched the game against the Patriots or one of the playoff games. For my goodness, you would have really gotten riled up.
You can see so and so just earned himself the jackpot in the bounty.
I mean, I did think about watching.
Won, I did not get up.
I did think about watching the Cardinals game, but I've seen that game more than I have the Washington game. So I'm like, yeah, let me just do the Washington game.
I've watched the highlights game. That game, I've never gone back and watched the full game. And it's purely because like, I actually like Kurt Warner a lot as a quarterback and a person. And he gets completely mauled. Like,
destroyed.
I loved watching Brett Favre get retired. Didn't bother me at all. That at the end of that game, I'm like, damn, Kurt, you should have retired last year. Like that was.
Did you watch the Kurt Warner movie?
Yes.
With he definitely can't. What's his name? Zach. Shazam. He can't throw a pass.
Yeah. No.
No.
Should I watch that?
Nope. Thank you.
All right. That's everything we got for you, everybody. We want to thank our loyal listeners for downloading each week and telling all of your friends to listen to the Dome Patrol podcast. Follow us on Facebook. Just look for Dome Patrol podcast. Follow us on Twitter at Dome Patrol PCast and at Dome Patrol UK. Check us out on TikTok at Dome Patrol Prods. That's PRODZ. And if you want to listen to us the old-fashioned way, go to DomePatrolPodcast.com. Say bye-bye, donkeys.
Bye-bye, no more football donkeys.
Bye-bye, big fish donkeys.
Good night, Who Dat Nation.
Big fish?
Troutman. Adam Troutman.
Why are you saying bye-bye to Troutman? He looked good.
I was telling the donkeys bye. Listen, this stupid donkeys thing has never been explained to me, except for I know it's a fantasy football thing, which none of our listeners care about. So if I'm not doing it correctly, that's not my fault.
You don't have to do anything. Just let Jason do it.
Right.
You just say bye-bye, something stupid, and donkeys. I got it.
Right. That's what Jason does.
Big fish fits perfectly.
So it's a play on the donkeys, which is crime donkeys, fantasy football, but donkey just kind of took over. But it's also a play on Walton and Johnson at the end of the show. They'd say bye-bye, Billy Ed.
Bye-bye, Billy Ed.
So I did bye-bye, and then I just switched it to donkeys.
Yes.
Also, the Dome Patrol stands for Donkey Online Media Entertainment. Dome.
That is true.
So I want to say bye-bye, Dome Patrol.
Bye-bye, domies. Say bye-bye, domies.
It doesn't have that same ring to it.
Say bye-bye, dummies.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Bye-bye, dummies.